Today we will be covering agroforestry. In the previous class we have already talked about what is social forestry. A brief recap on social forestry. We can say social forestry is when we talk about forestry of the people, for the people and by the people. Now agroforestry is a branch of social forestry. So I can say it's a branch of social forestry where we specifically deal with maintaining a sustainable development including trees, crops, livestock. The livestock includes your all animals. And then you try to maintain a sustainable balance and increase your yield. To develop or maintain sustainable balance and increase the yield, what we need to do is we need to improve technologically. So technology is very important in case of agroforestry. In social forestry, most of the social forestries that we cover, we can say it's a kind of mass mobilization movement. So if there is a lot of people who are involved into it, you can achieve better success. But in case of agroforestry, you definitely need good technology and research work to develop agroforestry on specific lines. Under agroforestry, we also try to produce maximum output and protect the existing resource base. We try to use as many indigenous species as we can. Most of the things that we are trying to use under social forestry and agroforestry must require low input conditions. The primary reason for this is if the low input conditions are not required, what would happen is farmers and the homeowners would have to bear a lot, and that would definitely incur huge cost. And the aim of social forestry and agroforestry primarily is to distribute that cost. So it is important that there are low input conditions. Definitely agroforestry is much more complex phenomena. So it's structurally and functionally much more complex than any other form of forestry. If we talk about general agricultural production, it's definitely not that structurally complex, because you need to develop just the technology and give a basic idea on how the agricultural crops must be grown. But where you are trying to do all things in one ambit, you are trying to grow trees, you are trying to grow the agricultural produce or the crops, and you are also trying to maintain a good livestock, you need a big resource base, okay? And you need to protect those resource base. Now when we talk about agroforestry, we can classify agroforestry by various means. There are three primary classifications that we talk about. First is the structural classification. The next is the functional classification. And the last is the spatial classification. So it is either spatial or temporal. Okay, so under the first classification, what we talk about, structural classification. So structural classification basically deals with three things. You have agri-silvicultural practices, you have silvopastoral culture and agro-silvopastoral culture. Under functional classification, we talk about two types. So functional classification can either be productive or protective. So it is either productive or protective. And finally, based on component, we can say it can be either spatial or temporal. So if I start with component, I can say it can be spatial or temporal. So spatial, as the name suggests, deals with the area. So in which area, which kind of crops and which kind of trees should be grown, what should be the livestock in a particular area would be covered under spatial. Under temporal, it mainly deals with time. So you have how the temporal variations occur over time. So it is specifically applies in cases of shifting agriculture. If I say you have 2 to 4 years of cropping season, or fallow area, then the next 10 to 15 years would be the next cycle. You would keep that land fallow, and again for next 2 to 4 years you will try to cultivate on that land. So that's a kind of temporal framework that I'm trying to provide. And a functional approach, as we mentioned, you have either productive approach or protective approach. Productive, if I say, I mean it can be in terms of food, it can be in terms of fodder, it can be in terms of providing shelter. Okay, so these are all means of productive functions. Whereas protective functions would deal with acting as windbreakers, that we have already discussed in the class on social forestry. You have windbreakers, you have shelter lines. So these would all be kind of protective approach in agroforestry. Now we'll move on to the main component, that's the structural approach. And a structural approach, as I said, we talk about three basic components or three basic types. The first one here is, we call it as agri-silviculture. So it's agri-silviculture approach. So as you can see in the diagram, rather than making the things confusing or complicated, it's just as simple as that. You have series of plantations that are growing on the two sides, and you have trees that are lying in between. So I can say, if this is a farm plot, I will have grasses here or agricultural growth here, I will have agricultural plantation here, and in between there would be series of trees. So as you can see, in this region you have the grasses or the agricultural produce, this region again has grasses or the agricultural produce, and in between you have a row of trees. So that is what is agri-silvicultural practice. The next thing that we talk about is silvipastoral culture. Silvipastoral practices, as you can see here, you try to maintain agricultural produce plus the livestock. Okay, so I can just try to jot down those in equation form. So if I say silvipastoral culture, silvipastoral activities, so that would include agriculture and livestock. In the previous one where we talked about agri-silviculture, we talked about agriculture plus trees. Okay. And the last one that we would be talking about is agro-silvipastoral practices. In this, we talk about mainly agriculture plus trees plus livestock. So that is as simple as it. So these are the structural components. So this diagram depicts the silvipastoral practices. So as you can see here, you have an agricultural land and you have livestock nearby. Now silvipastoral culture can be practiced for a variety of reasons. First is maintaining the protein banks. How do you do that? You try to grow crops like alfalfa and crops which have rich protein, which are rich in protein, and ultimately what happens is those crops act as a fodder for the livestock. So that is one of the practices that you can do. The next practices here that you can do is creating fences or agricultural fence around where you can keep your animals. And third is creating pastures. So these are the three main elements of, I should say, silvipastoral practices. So basic element here is agriculture along with livestock. The next here, as we can see, it's agro-silvipastoral culture practices. So under agro-silvipastoral culture, we can see you have agriculture here, you have trees, and you have livestock. So it includes agriculture, trees and livestock. And in short, we can say It is a kind of practice that is most prevalent in the countries of South Asia, Southeast Asia. The main aim of agri-silvopastoral culture is to promote maximum utilization of the land, provide best technology for development of fodder. So you have grasses which are agricultural regions which are rich in protein, which acts as a fodder for animals. Under agro-silvopastoral culture practices, you have two major things that we usually talk about. First is home gardens, and so I can say there are two major elements. You have hedgerows and home gardens. Now what is important to understand here is, under hedgerows what happens is, you try to grow a kind of boundary or a kind of series of plants or shrubs, and they are kind of trained, so they are, you can say they are trimmed at the same level, and I can say that is a kind of hedgerow. If I talk about woody hedgerows, it would be a series of plants or trees that are growing around, or wooden trees that are. So as you can see here on the back side, you have trees, so it's a kind of woody hedgerow. And then you have the next practice, which is home gardens. Home gardens is again prevalent mostly in the Southeast Asian countries, mainly in Japan and the coastal areas. So what you have is, you have agricultural practices in three levels. The lowest level here is on the base. So you have the grasses here, then you have the trees above, and finally you have an intermediate structure which is going somewhere near, like kind of shrubs or herbs which are growing here. Okay. Now the next year is, what are the important benefits or important things that we can get from agroforestry? So we can say you get environmental benefits, you get economic benefits, there are definite social benefits. We'll first talk about environmental benefits. As we have already discussed these things in social forestry, we can say it reduces pressure on the forest, that's for sure. It tries to maintain our ecological system. Since we are growing a lot of trees around, the surface runoff would definitely stop. So the problem of erosion would decrease. Then you have lower soil surface temperature that would kind of lead to reduced evaporation. These practices try to increase the soil nutrient capacity, because you are growing soils, plantation that is rich in protein and nutrients, mainly nitrogen. Then you try to improve the soil structure of the soil, of the region. Now economic benefits, as we can see, it definitely increases the amount of fodder, fuel wood, fodder, fertilizer, timber that's being used. It decreases the chances of crop failure. The income of a farmer increases, and ultimately it leads to higher productivity in the region. There are a lot of social implications. It improves the standard of living of the local dwellers. It improves the level of nutrition, because you are growing crops that are rich in certain nutrients, and those crops would be provided to the dwellers also. Then you try to improve the communities as such. Now the most important thing we will talk about is, what is the difference between agroforestry and the social forestry? In the previous class we talked about social forestry. In this class we have already discussed about what is agroforestry. Now we will come on to what are the basic differences between agroforestry and social forestry. The first and the foremost difference here is, under social forestry, if there is any fallow land, you can utilize that land to grow crops, or you can utilize that land to grow kind of forest crops. So it's use of fallow lands which is there in social forestry. But for agroforestry, you definitely need a technology which must be developed before you are trying to implement that. The next is, social forestry includes all kind of fodder crops. So forest crops, fodder, which is, can be used for fodder, fuel wood, or anything that meets the local demand of the area. Why? In agroforestry, we try to maintain agriculture, we try to maintain cropping patterns, we try to develop a kind of forest region along with livestock, and this is not only meant for meant to fulfill the local demands, in contrast to most of the social practices, social forestry practices, we are trying to meet only the local demand of the people. Also, for economic agroforestry, there are economic perspectives that are important, in contrast to social forestry, where we just focus on the social demands of the people and the social requirements that we aim to fulfill. If there is any unproductive land in the forest, it would come under social forestry practices, but that would not happen for an agroforestry. For agroforestry, if the land is kind of dry land or an alkaline land, it can definitely come under social forestry practice under agroforestry practices. But for social forestry practices, it's very important that any unproductive land would become a part of social forestry practices. Under social forestry, forest crops can be grown either individually or in combination with any other forest crops. But while in agroforestry, we try to know the demand of the region. Based on the demand of the region, we try to grow the crops. So it's much more demand driven. So the basic concept of economics of demand and supply here applies here. So it is mainly governed by the demand in the market or the local area, while this is governed independently. They are not focusing on what is the demand of the local people, but their aim is to satisfy, or their aim is to fulfill the local needs. So whatever crop they are growing, it's immaterial that there is a specific demand of, say, spinach in the region, but they can grow any crop that satisfies the food production or the agricultural requirement of that region. So that those are the basic differences between agroforestry and social forestry. We will be covering more topics in biogeography in the further lessons. You can subscribe to ExamBridge channel for further updates. Have a good day.